Hello everyone, welcome to the fifth tutorial class on analog communication, and this class will be presented by myself Dr. Sudhip Mondal, assistant professor of EC department, Jalpaiguri Government Engineering College. Now coming to the agenda of this class, basically this class is focused on demodulation of AM. So what is demodulation? So basically it is a process through which we can extract the original message or baseband signal from the modulated wave. By using transmitter, we can transmit the modulated wave. Okay. And so that it can transmit a long distance effectively. At the receiver end, our main objective will be to extract the original message. So that is the demodulation. We can also call it as detection. Okay, so in this class we shall mainly discuss about the demodulation process of DSB type of AM. Next we shall discuss about the different process related with the demodulation, like synchronous and asynchronous process. And after that, for the synchronous process, we shall observe what will happen if phase and frequency mismatch occur. After that, we shall discuss about the operating principle of Costa's receiver that is used to demodulate or detect the DSBAC signal. And last, we'll cover the operation of envelope detector, which is very popular demodulation technique to demodulate DSB AM signal. Okay, so let's move on. So this is the first slide, that is the what is the definition of demodulation. As we already discussed, that it is a process to extract or reconstruct or detect the message or baseband signal from the modulated wave. That is the demodulation. Now demodulation can be classified into two types. Okay, one is synchronous, another is asynchronous. So the name suggests that synchronous with whom? Synchronous with the carrier signal. That means in case of synchronous detection or demodulation, we need to use the carrier signal frequency in the receiver end, whereas in case of asynchronous detection, we don't need to use any carrier signal at the receiver end. Okay, so we shall discuss or we shall observe different kind of techniques in the upcoming slide. And importantly, we should note down that right now in this class we shall discuss only the demodulation for DSB AM signal only. Now coming to the synchronous detection. Now this is the basic block diagram for synchronous demodulation of AM signal. As you can see, there is a receiving antenna that receive the modulated wave, and we already know that if we consider the DSBSC signal, so the equation for the modulated wave will be xt into cos omega ct. Okay, now if we multiply the incoming receiving signal with the cos omega ct, that is the original carrier signal, so the corresponding output will be et, that is the xt into cos square omega ct. Okay, so you can see that this cos omega ct can be either locally generated, or it can be a pilot carrier in case of DSBFC signal. Okay, so in case of synchronous detection, this part is important or crucial, because here one of the input of the multiplier is cos omega ct, that is the carrier signal. Okay, now if the output of the multiplier is passing through a low pass filter, we can get original message signal, that is half xt. Now how can we get output as half xt from the low pass filter? Let's see the mathematical analysis. Yes, you can see that output of the multiplier et equal to xt cos omega ct multiplied by cos omega ct. So it can be written as like half into 2 xt into cos square omega ct. Now cos square omega ct is expressed in term of 2 cos omega ct, sorry, cos 2 omega ct. Okay, so et can be written as like this: half into xt multiplied by 1 plus cos 2 omega ct. So ultimately we get et equal to half xt plus half xt into cos 2 omega ct. So just observe this corresponding equation, that this equation consists of two parts. First part denotes the original message. Only difference is that its amplitude is divided by 2, but the signal remains same. And the second part, that is denoted another modulated wave, but its carrier frequency is twice omega c. Okay, so obviously this is unwanted part. Okay, so and it can be seen that 2 omega c, that means it is multiplied with high frequency component. Okay, and its spectrum, the spectrum of the xt will be shifted into the plus minus 2 omega c. So obviously this is the higher frequency component and this is the lower frequency components. And if this signal is passing through a low pass filter, as the operating principle of low pass filter is to pass a low frequency signal and it cut the high frequency signal, so ultimately we get the xt, half xt. So now by using the Fourier transform, we can rewrite this equation in the frequency domain, that e omega equal to half x omega plus 1 by 4 x omega plus 2 omega c plus x omega minus 2 omega c. As we already know, in case of modulated wave, the original spectrum of the signal is shifted at the corresponding plus minus carrier frequency. So here carrier frequency is 2 omega c, so your spectrum will be shifted to the 2 omega c. So let's see it the corresponding frequency domain. So yes, this is the corresponding spectrum of the output of the multiplier. You can see that this spectrum denote the half x omega, that means this represent the original message signal. And you can see that the spectrum of the x omega is also shifted at plus minus 2 omega c, okay, where the amplitude is 1 by 4 x omega. Okay, so this portion denote the high frequency component and this is the unwanted part. So if you use a low pass filter whose center frequency is zero, or obviously the center frequency will be zero, and it's if the low pass filter is band limited to that omega m, and obviously what will happen, the signal or the output of the corresponding low pass filter will be just this portion, half x omega, because it will pass only the low pass signal, and ultimately we get the demodulated original signal or baseband signal. Okay, and remember, the synchronous detection is also termed as the coherent detection. Synchronous or coherent denotes the same, that means the process is synchronized with the carrier signal frequency omega c. Clear? So this is the basic operation of a synchronous demodulator. So synchronous demodulator consists of two part. One is multiplier and there is low pass filter. The input of the multiplier is, one input is xt cos omega ct, another is cos omega ct, that is the carrier. Now this carrier can be either locally generated or it can be either pilot carrier, that is transmitted along the DSBFC signal. Okay, now the output of the multiplier is passing through the low pass filter, and we can see that output of the multiplier consists of two part. One is the originally baseband signal, and that is the frequency spectrum that is shifted into a plus minus 2 omega c, that is the higher frequency component. And if it passes through the low pass filter, we get the low frequency part, that is the half into xt, that is original baseband signal. And if we multiply it by if it passes through a amplifier, and we get ultimately xt signal. Okay, so our objective is to xt. So by using this process, we can get, or we can extract xt from modulated wave by using simple process, synchronous process. Okay, now let's see. As you already told, that the carrier should be synchronous or same with the modulated wave. Now a carrier has two part, one is the phase and the frequency. Okay, now phase frequency will be the same and the phase should be zero. Now if this frequency and phase are differed from the original carrier signal, then there will be some kind of problem, or there will be some distortion at the receiving end. So let's see how phase and frequency mismatch occurred in case of synchronous detection. Okay, so let us consider that the incoming signal is a DSBAC signal, that is the XT cos omega CT. And locally generated carrier is not exactly cos omega CT, but its frequency is differed by delta omega and it has a initial phase of phi. So we can write that locally generated carrier equal to cos omega C plus delta omega T plus phi. Okay, so here delta omega and phi are frequency error and phase difference respectively. Okay, now as we know that this received signal and locally generated carrier will be multiplied. So ST into CLT, if we multiplied it, then we get the output of the multiplied EDT, and this multiplication can be expressed in term of like cos A into cos B equal to cos A plus B into cos A minus B. Okay, so we can write that half XT cos delta omega T plus phi plus half XT cos omega C plus omega C 2 omega C plus delta omega T plus phi. So ultimately we get the output of the multiplied as this equation. Okay, now you can easily observe that this part denote the high frequency component. So the output of the low pass filter will be nothing but half into XT into cos delta omega T plus phi. Clear? So output of the low pass filter, if there is phase and frequency mismatch, so that will be half into XT cos delta omega T plus phi. Okay, now you can see that here XT is multiplied by a slow time varying signal, that is the, what is the time varying signal? Cos delta omega T plus phi. Now why do we call it as a slow time varying signal? Because omega and delta omega and phi are very small. Now there will be four case that is possible. Okay, so the first case, so at delta omega equal to 0 and phi is 0. So this is the ideal case. That means there is no frequency and phase mismatch. Okay, so if delta omega and phi is 0, so obviously the output of the respective low pass filter will be half XT. That means there is no distortion in the detected output. This is the ideal case. But if delta omega, consider the second scenario where delta omega equal to 0, that means no frequency mismatch, but there is phase difference, that means phi equal to 0, phi is not equal to 0. So what will be the reason behind it? Because phase difference can occur due to the multipath propagation from one point to another point, and it can be also randomly varied due to the variation in the ionosphere also. Okay, so for this purpose there will be some kind of phase difference. So if this condition occur, so ultimately the output of the low pass filter will be written as like half XT into cos phi. Okay, now you can see that XT is multiplied by cos phi, where phi can be varied. Okay, now it is interesting to observe that depending on the value of cos phi, the E0 to value will be either maximum to minimum, or it can be either 0. You can see that if phi equal to 0, then obviously E0t will be minimum. E0t will be maximum if phi equal to 0, because cos phi is 0 equal to 1, so we get the original signal. But if phi equal to plus minus 90 degree, then what will happen? If phi equal to plus minus 90 degree, then obviously the E0t will be 0. That means we will get no output at the receiving end. So you can see that in spite of receiving signal at the receiving end, but due to the phase difference of the cos phi or of the carrier signal, we cannot get any kind of signal. Okay, now this condition or this effect is known as the quadrature null effect. That means if the phase difference is plus minus 90 degree, then the output of the low pass filter will become 0. So this is called as quadrature null effect. Okay, it has important application that will be discussed in the upcoming slide. Now coming to the next condition, that is the इफ डेल्टा ओमेगा इज नॉट इक्वल टू जीरो, इट विल बी नॉट डेल्टा ओमेगा. ओके सो डेल्टा ओमेगा इज नॉट इक्वल टू जीरो बट फाई इक्वल टू जीरो, देन ऑब्वियसली व्हाट विल हैपन, द आउटपुट ऑफ द लो पास फिल्टर विल बी हाफ एक्स टी इंटू के कॉस डेल्टा ओमेगा टी. सो यू कैन सी दैट द आउटपुट ऑफ द लो पास फिल्टर इज डिस्टॉर्टेड विद द टाइम वेरिंग सिग्नल, बिकॉज व्हाई डू यू कॉल इट टाइम वेरिंग सिग्नल, बिकॉज दिस इज कॉस डेल्टा ओमेगा टी, दैट मीन्स द वैल्यू ऑफ द कॉस डेल्टा ओमेगा टी इज चेंज्ड फ्रॉम प्लस 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 माइनस फ्रॉम प्लस वन टू माइनस वन. So obviously the respective output will be distorted by this time varying signal, and this is known as the beating effect. So when the beating effect happens, when the phase difference is zero but the frequency difference is not zero, at that time beating effect will happen. Now at the last scenario, which is the worst scenario, if delta omega is not equal to 0 and phi is not equal to 0, then what will happen? Then obviously 0 to will be half xt cos delta omega t plus phi. So obviously in that case the signal is seriously distorted, and as well as it will be attenuated for this case. Okay, here you can see that delta, as delta omega is very small, so that distortion is small, but in this case it is cos delta omega t plus phi, both phase and frequency are responsible for the distortion. That's why the signal is seriously distorted. So this is the fourth scenario that can happen. So when delta omega and phi both are zero, that is the ideal case, and when delta omega and phi both are not zero, this is the worst scenario where the signal is seriously distorted. And when delta omega equal to zero but phi is not equal to zero, then quadrature null effect can happen. And where delta omega equal to not equal to zero but phi equal to zero, in that case there is some distortion that is generated due to the time varying signal, and this is known as the beating effect. So this is the fourth scenario that can happen if the phase and frequency mismatch occur for the carrier signal in case of synchronous or coherent detection. Clear? Now let's coming to the important part, that is the carrier synchronization process. We already mentioned already used the term synchronization, but how can you synchronize the carrier in the receiver section? So there are two way that we can use for the synchronization purpose. One is the pilot carrier. So if you consider the DSB-FC signal, double sideband full carrier signal, so in that case along with the modulated wave we send another carrier term that is known as the pilot carrier. Okay, so you can see that the equation for the DSB-FC equal to a cos omega ct plus x t into cos omega ct. So this term is the pilot carrier. Now if we use the appropriate filter in the receiving end, so you can easily extract this cos omega ct from this equation, and you can use further for the detection purpose. So this is the simple way to get the carrier signal. Okay, but designing this appropriate filter is very tough. That is the main disadvantage. However, and more in case of DSB-FC, power is also wasted in term of carrier. Now next is the Costa's receiver. By using Costa's receiver we can detect DSB-SC signal, or we can demodulate the DSB-SC signal. So here you can see that this is the incoming signal, you can incoming receiving modulated wave, that is AXT cos omega CT. There is a two product modulator, two low pass filter, and one is the phase discriminator. The function of the phase discriminator is to differentiate between generate the phase difference between two incoming signal. And this is the VCO, that means this is the voltage control oscillator. The input of the voltage control oscillator is a DC signal, but the output is an oscillating signal. That means depending on the incoming DC voltage of the VCO, the output of the VCO can be changed. Okay, and this is the, you can see that there is written as 90 degree phase shifter. That means it's the output of the minus 90 degree phase shifter is nothing but it generates the output signal by shifting minus 90 degree phase shift of the input signal. Okay, so and you can see that there is a closed loop created by using phase discriminator VCO, and upper channel, upper part is known as the I channel, and lower is known as the Q channel. I stand for in channel and Q stand for quadrature channel. Here we have used the quadrature null effect. Okay, let's see how the Costa receiver worked. Here you can see that at this point we have written cos omega ct plus phi. So basically this is the locally generated carrier that is generated by the voltage control oscillator. Okay, so the output of the voltage control oscillator is cos omega ct plus phi, while phi is the phase difference. Now this locally generated carrier will go to the product modulator 1, and it will go to the minus 90 degree phase shifter. So the output of the minus 90 degree phase shifter will be sin omega ct plus phi, and here and the incoming signal will go to the both product modulator. So the first product modulator, the incoming signal, the output of the product modulator will be AXT cos omega ct into cos omega ct plus phi, and output of the second product modulator will be AXT cos omega ct into sin omega ct plus phi. That means in case of I channel we get XT cos omega ct into cos omega ct plus phi, and in case of Q channel we get the output of the product modulator as AXT cos omega ct into sin omega ct plus phi. Now we can express this both term in term of high frequency component and low frequency component. Okay, so similarly we can if you use a low pass filter in I channel and Q channel also, the output of the low pass filter in case of I channel will be half into A into XT into cos phi. We already discussed it. Okay, half AXT into cos phi, and the Q channel, so you can see that the output of the second low pass filter in case of Q channel, half into A into XT into sin phi. So how can you write it? So if you can see that if delta omega equal to 0 and phi is not equal to 0, then obviously the output of the respective multiplier will be half XT into cos phi. So as we are using sinusoidal signal in the second case or sine wave, so output of the second low pass filter will be half XT into sin phi, but output of the first low pass filter in case of I channel, it will be nothing but half XT into cos phi. Okay, now the output of the both low pass filter will go to the phase discriminator. Okay, now the function of the phase discriminator is nothing but to generate the phase difference. Based on the phase difference, it will create a DC voltage signal. Now this DC voltage signal is applied in the VCO. Now depending on this DC voltage signal, the output of the voltage VCO will be changed, phase will be differed. Okay, so this is the closed loop feedback system. Until unless this system is synchronized or locked, the change in the output of the phase discriminator will happen, and this consequently the change in the VCO, change in the output of the VCO will also happen. We call it as lock condition when the output of the phase discriminator will become zero. That means phi become zero. Okay, so at this scenario quadrature null effect will happen. That means ultimately we get half AXT if phi equal to 0, and the output of the Q channel half AXT into sin phi. That means if phi equal to 0, then means this will become 0. So we get ultimately demodulated wave at the I channel if lock happen in this Costa's receiver. Okay, this is the closed loop feedback system, and that means if phi, suppose phi equal to 10 radian, so initially there will be phase dependence, then again depending on the value of VCO there will be some kind of change. Now again they will compare, that means it will be continuous process, and ultimately after some time the total process will be locked and it will get the it will the total process will be synchronized. Okay, so here it is already written that if properly synchronized or phi equal to 0, that means I channel has the output half xt into cos 0, that is half xt, and Q channel has the output half xt into sin 0, so 0. Okay, so I channel actually give the desired demand ultrasound signal after proper synchronization. So that is the operating principle of Costa's receiver, where we don't use any kind of pilot carrier, but we use the locally generated carrier, and we also use the some phase discriminator at VCO to create a feedback loop, so that ultimately we get a locked or synchronized condition where phase difference become zero. Clear? I hope the operation is very clear to you, and if any confusion, please post them. Now coming to the next part of the detection process, that is the asynchronous detection or asynchronous demodulation. So as the name suggests, asynchronous, that means we don't need to use any kind of carrier here. Okay, so the use of Costa's receiver or pilot carrier, these are irrelevant in this in case of asynchronous detection. Okay, and the process is not necessarily be synchronized with the modulated signal. And one of the example of such kind of asynchronous detector is envelope detector. Okay, so envelope detector is very popular and cheap kind of demodulator that has been widely used in the demodulation purpose of DSB signal. Okay, so you can see this is the basically circuit diagram of a simple envelope detector circuit. You can see that this is the receiving signal or ST, receiving modulated wave. So this denote the receiving modulated wave, and it consists of a diode and a simple RC circuit. Okay, so and RC are connected like this way. So after diode, C is connected with this like this way, and load resistor is also connected to the parallel of the capacitor. And output of the the detected output will be taken from the RL resistor. Okay, across the RL resistor. Now, before starting the operation of the envelope detector, let us discuss why do we call it as envelope detector. We already know in case of DSB that message is embedded or lies in the envelope of the AM signal. Why? If you observe, just remember that if you observe the time domain representation of a DSBFC signal, in that case we can observe that the you can see that. So this is the envelope. Okay, so actually this envelope is nothing but the message signal. So if we can able to detect the envelope from the incoming modulated wave, so that will nothing but the detected message signal or baseband signal. So the basically by using this kind of circuit, we ultimately want to detect the envelope of the incoming modulated wave, which in turn detect the message or baseband signal. That's why we use the term envelope detector. Okay, now remember, for envelope detector two conditions should be satisfied. First of all, AM should have narrow bandwidth, that means the message bandwidth should be less than the carrier bandwidth. It is quite easy to understand. That means FM should be less than FC. Okay, so that is the first condition. And the second condition is that mu should be less than equal to 1. That means the envelope detector is applicable only for under and critical modulation. In case of over modulation, the value of modulation index is greater than 1. And we already observed that in case of over modulation, the two envelope, that means upper envelope and lower envelope, will overlap with each other, and this envelope will be, and ultimately the signal is seriously distorted. That's why over modulation condition is not desirable. Okay, so as the in case of under and critical modulation, the envelope are not hampered, so that's why envelope detector is only applicable for under or critical modulation or when mu less than equal to 1. Clear? So in case of over modulation, envelope detector is not applicable. That means it is not possible to detect the baseband signal properly. Okay, now let's see the operating principle of this envelope detector or this circuit. Now, you can see that this is the carrier signal whose amplitude is modulated or changed according with the baseband signal. Now, in case of positive half cycle, that means when ST become positive and it will try to go to the maximum amplitude. So in that case, this diode become forward bias. And when this diode is on, that means this capacitor will be charged up to the maximum amplitude of the modulated wave or ST at that instance. So there is charging path. So charging path is going through the diode and capacitor, and it is applicable when the modulated signal or when the modulated wave is trying to reach its positive peak or in the positive half cycle. Now, when the signal is started to fall below the maximum peak of the modulated wave, then what will happen? In that case, it will become negative and it will become positive because capacitor will not discharge easily. Okay, so what will happen? Diode will become in reverse bias. That means no current will flow across the diode. So what will happen? The stored charge in the capacitor will slowly discharge through the detector, through the resistor or load resistance RL. Okay, so discharging path will be through the RL. So in the positive half cycle, when the signal is try to reach the maximum peak of the amplitude of the modulated wave, then charging will happen. When the diode is for in forward bias, capacitor will be charged to its maximum value, and when the signal is trying to fall below the peak voltage level, then what will happen? Diode become the reverse bias and the capacitor will be discharging through the resistance. So let's say what will happen. So you can see that this is the ultimate the modulated wave, and this dotted signal denote the actually the envelope. So ultimate actually the signal is look like this. So when just starting from this 0 point, so when the ST will gradually increase to its maximum amplitude, so at that time capacitor will also charge it up to its maximum value. Now when the ST is gradually falling that maximum amplitude, what will happen? So you can see that the black line denote the amplitude of the ST, and it will fall below the maximum limit, maximum amplitude. So in that case, what will happen? The capacitor will not discharge instantly. We can set the time constant of the capacitor or charging or discharging time of the capacitor such that its charging kind of is very high. That means whenever the ST will reach to its maximum amplitude, so capacitor should also charge it up instantly. That means the charging time is very large, should be very large. Now, whenever the amplitude of the ST is fall below its maximum level, so at that time what will happen? Diode become reverse bias, and diode become reverse bias, and you can see that the capacitor will be trying to discharge through the resistance, so the respective voltage level will gradually fall. But as the discharging time constant is high, we need to select or we need to set the discharging time such that it will take longer time for the discharging. So what will happen? So the voltage output of the voltage level, output of the load resistor will gradually fall. So you can get this kind of red line that denote the respective output of the load resistance RL. And you can see that when again the volt amplitude of the ST cross the voltage level, output of the voltage level, or output of, sorry, cross the voltage level of the capacitor, so again diode will be forward bias and again it will be charged up, and after that again it will be discharged. So charging, discharging, charging, discharging, like this way it will happen, and ultimately we get the output, detector output, like this way. You can see that the output follow the envelope, but it contains some ripple. You can easily ripple this kind of ripple by using some RCL filter. Okay, so that is another part, but you can see that just observe the respective operation. Okay, so in the positive half cycle again the charging will happen, and when the voltage level of the ST falls below the peak amplitude, then the discharging will happen, and discharging will happen through the resistor, RL resistor. Okay, so detector output will be consist of either charging and discharging process. So thus by charging and discharging process, the voltage across the capacitor follow the envelope of the modulated wave, and we get the baseband signal at the output end. Okay, so this is the operation of the envelope detector. Here you can see that dotted line denote the envelope, black line denote actually the original ST or DSB FC signal, and red line denote the actually detected output. You can see that when ST is trying to is increase its voltage level is increasing, ST the respective capacitor is charged up, and we get the this amount of voltage level. But when it's fall below its peak amplitude, then the diode is reverse bias, and it will try to discharge through the RL resistor, but the discharging time is set such that discharging will not occur instantly. So after that, that's why it will gradually fall, output will gradually fall, and after some time again when the value of ST will cross the amplitude of the amplitude of the voltage level of capacitor, again the capacitor will be charged up, and again it will be charged to its maximum amplitude, and after that again discharging will occur, again charging, again discharging, like this way, and we get ultimately detected output. Okay, now this is the basic operation, you can see that. But to operate the envelope detector, there is some kind of condition that must be satisfied. Okay, now assume that RF is the forward bias resistance of the diode, and RS is the internal series resistance. Okay, internal series resistance that is for the source. So that we know that the in case of RC circuit, the charging and discharging time is RC, R into C, which is also known as the time constant of the RC circuit. Okay, so in case of charging, so the charging time will be RF plus RS into C. So RF is the diode resistance and RS is the internal series resistance. Okay, so the as you can see that charging path is through diode and this path. So this path consists of resistance of diode and internal resistance. So RF plus RC into C, that is the charging time. And discharging time, so you can see that discharging path is through the RL resistance. So discharging path, so discharging time will be RL into C. So here the value of RF, RS and RL is very crucial. Okay, now let us consider that fc and fm are the carrier modulating frequency. fc and fm are the carrier and modulating frequency respectively. Okay, now we can already observe that if charging time should be very small, okay, charging time should be very small compared to the time period of the carrier. That means this is the time period between, this is the time period of the carrier from this point to this point. If this charging time is high, then to charge the capacitor it will take a longer time. Okay, that means at that time it will not able to follow the envelope. Suppose it will the output will be look like this. So at this point, suppose at this point the capacitor will be maximally charged, so it will not follow this variation of amplitude. Okay, so this is we should consider that the charging time, which is nothing but Rf plus Rs into C, that should be very small with compared to the time period of the carrier signal. So what, so the time period means 1 by fc. Okay, so obviously we can write that Ra plus Rs into C is less than 1 by fc. So this is the first condition for the charging time. Now let's see the discharging condition. There is two possible condition happen. Now consider discharging time is very high, then what will happen? That means it will take very long time for the discharging. Okay, so you can see that at this point there is no when the signal is rising, there is no problem, like when the envelope has the positive, so there is no problem. But when the envelope is gradually falling, you can see that as the discharging time is very large, so what will happen? The output of the capacitor, voltage level of the capacitor will not discharge easily. Okay, so it will take very large time or to reach the to discharge through the load resistance. So what will happen? So like this way, it will be discharged through resistance, and ultimately we get this kind of output. So you can see that easily at this part it cannot able to catch the variation of the modulating wave, it does not able to follow the curve. Now if the discharging time is very small, then what will happen? So suppose at this point consider discharging time is very small, so what will happen? So whenever ST will become less than the respective maximum amplitude, so what will happen? Capacitor will instantly discharge. Okay, and after this point it will again charge to the maximally point. So what will happen ultimately? You can see that this output has very large ripple. Okay, and to remove this such kind of ripple is not very easy task or quite difficult. Okay, so we need to select the time constant, discharging time, such that it will not able to get very much ripple, but it will also able to follow the curve or follow the envelope. That means we need to select a optimal value of discharging time constant. So you can see that if RLC is very large, then slow discharging will be held and output will not able to follow the variation on the modulating signal. On the other hand, if RLC is very small, then fast discharging will occur and large or huge ripple will be observed in the output wave. Okay, so we should select RLC in this manner, that it should be less than the time period of the modulating wave, but it should be very large compared to the 1 by fc. Okay, so this is the optimal condition. So RLC should be greater than 1 by fc, but less than 1 by fm. That is the main condition. So this is the optimal condition of the envelope detector. So this is the condition for the charging time, discharging time. This is the condition for the discharging time for the effective operation of the envelope detector. Clear? So coming to the conclusion, so in this class we have studied different demodulation technique like synchronous and asynchronous process. In case of synchronous process, we have observed the pilot carrier and coaster receiver, and we have also observed what will happen if there is phase and frequency mismatch occurred in carrier signal. And after that, we have observed the very popular asynchronous process, that is the envelope detector, and how it will occurred. Envelope detector is very popular because its circuit, you can see that it consists of only diode and resistance and capacitor. Very easy circuit, and that's why it is very popular. But the time constant, discharging time and charging time, that should be selected very carefully, so that it can able to catch the variation of the envelope as the baseband signal is remain in the envelope of the modulated wave. And also consider the under and critical modulation only for the effective operation of the envelope detector. Envelope detector is not applicable in case of over modulation. So that's all. These are the references. Thank you, and if you have any question, please post that. Thank you.